to Rutgers Around the World, a special six-episode series celebrating the university's international connections with the global community. We bring you this program as part of our 250th anniversary celebration. Hi, I'm Gabriela Milian.
And I'm Bruno Ferreira. Rutgers maintains these relationships through its GAIA centers. GAIA stands for Global Advancement and International Affairs.
In this episode, we'll focus on Rutgers' ties to Latin America and the Caribbean. These relationships offer exciting programs for students, as well as research and teaching opportunities for faculty. And now, here's reporter and undergraduate student Tara Reed with more.
Thanks, Gabriela. Rutgers has close to 40 international partnerships in Latin America and the Caribbean. Sometimes these relationships start right here at home.
As the number of immigrants coming from Latin America to the United States grows, so does the number of international relationships, and Rutgers has made cultivating ties with the continent a priority.
With Latin America, we have very strong relations with several countries, certainly with Mexico, with Brazil. We're developing new relationships in Peru, which is just coming out of being a conflict zone, and Cuba, recently opened to the United States.
Students interested in Latin America have a menu of courses to choose from.
The Department of Latino and Caribbean Studies has been international since its inception. We focus on the Hispanic, the Anglophone, the Francophone, and the Dutch Caribbean.
As of 2014, we now have 25% of our student body who identifies Hispanic, Latino. So that creates a new set of responsibilities and opportunities.
Within the last year, the School of Environmental and Biological Sciences signed a double degree PhD agreement with the University of São Paulo in Brazil. This is the first of its kind at Rutgers.
Rutgers has a network of partnerships in Latin America, like the tripartite relationship between Rutgers, Ohio State, and the University of São Paulo.
The tripartite relationship between these three institutions began about 20 years ago to improve the capability of research and education by integrating the efforts between the faculties of these institutions.
I've been traveling to Cuba since 2001. Back then, Cuba was interested in restoring the city of Olavanas. So I was sending students there to do research.
These partnerships lead to projects that have the potential to impact society.
I'm actively engaged in state-of-the-art research. In Colombia, we identified that there were some areas, some populations that had a higher prevalence of suicide than others. And the suspicion we had is it may be related to bipolar disorder. And that was exactly the case.
We have a relationship with UNTREF in Argentina. And we have a program called the Argentina Trial Monitor. The biggest trial in Argentina ever is taking place, and we're working with them on that.
In Brazil, I work with a community that's in a favela, and we are trying to understand the social determinants of health. In this case, we're looking specifically at adolescents.
Building global relationships often begins with bridging gaps between Rutgers and local Latin American communities.
In New Brunswick, more than 50% of the residents speak languages other than English. So we created this conversation tree program where students participate as conversation facilitators and lead activities in English. Students then go to Yucatan in Mexico and are putting the conversation cafe model into action there.
For the past 2 years, we were able to train the advanced students in the medical Spanish and train them to become community interpreters, and they are able to interpret for our patient in New Brunswick.
Rutgers' connections with institutions in Latin America create opportunities for students to study abroad.
There are several study abroad opportunities for our students. We have a program in Mexico, in Oaxaca, on culture and community health. We have a program in Belize on animal science.
Over in the law school, one of the faculty members has been taking teams of students to the Dominican Republic every year to work on a house building program. We have a number of students and faculty who are right now in our College of Arts and Sciences thinking about and exploring some possibilities in Cuba.
Students travel from the States to Bolivia and they spend approximately 20 days in that country caring for women, caring for children. Some of the activities that they participate in are not exclusive to healthcare, but more field activities.
Another important trip, both at the law school and nursing, has been in Guatemala. Faculty are taking the students down to study the children coming into the country through Latin America and Mexico, and then coming back and writing papers about what needs to be changed.
The Global Village is located on Douglas Residential College. We have approximately a dozen different houses. This year we will have 3 houses travel, and they'll go to Mexico, the Dominican Republic, and Peru. And they're involved in service learning programs from a feminist social justice perspective.
Our acute care surgery fellows participate in the particular program in Colombia that train fellows in complex multi-cavitary trauma surgery. Much different than what they would see here.
And students return from Latin America with a new perspective on the world and themselves.
The International Leadership Exchange Program through Nicaragua was really life-changing. I remember specifically when we were doing a solar panel installation and how our team and some residents from Nicaragua came together for the betterment of this community that has never had electricity.
I studied abroad in Chile. I really was able to gain a competency of the language as well as just understand and develop myself as a traveler and as an American. That was probably the most incredible experience I've ever had.
It seems like there are study abroad programs for almost everyone, from learning a new language to working on a community project.
Absolutely. I actually just returned from a study abroad program in Guatemala.
Oh, what did you study there?
Media and struggles for democracy. And it was through the Department of Journalism and Media Studies. I noticed such a huge contrast between learning in the culture you're studying as opposed to just learning in a classroom. And on top of it being an extremely educational experience, it was truly the most humbling experience of my life.
Thank you, Tara. Rutgers' current international strategy is shaped around 5 focus countries: China, India, Indonesia, Liberia, and Brazil. These 5 countries offer the Rutgers community unique opportunities to collaborate with them and their neighbors.
Of these 5 focus countries, the one with the longest relationship is Brazil. Let's take a look.
We have had extensive interactions with Brazil, memoranda of understanding, delegations of faculty. We have sent students abroad. We have brought students and faculty to Rutgers. We have the tripartite activities between Rutgers and Ohio State University and University of São Paulo. So far, we have focused on energy-related projects. For example, biofuels production, plant science, biology, environmental science, and chemistry.
Partnering with University of São Paulo, we actually created transgenic sugarcane with our gene inserted in the sugarcane, and they become very tolerant to drought.
Gaia funding was, you know, deeply helpful in getting research support from the National Science Foundation. The intent is to understand the significance of changes to Brazilian class relations over the last 15 years.
One of the thrusts of our research is realizing the potential of this new crop called duckweed. These are aquatic plants able to grow on wastewater. We'd like to developed the duckweed platform in the northeast of Brazil.
Our faculty have research progress all over the Brazil. Professor from Brazil came over and we worked on, there is a seed in a fruit which is very starchy called pinhão, and we wanted to make value-added products from that seed.
Brazilian Scientific Mobility Program is a scholarship program for undergraduate and graduate level students to study abroad. The Brazilian government sponsors the program. Rutgers has had over 100 students participate. The faculty have said that they really appreciate having a different perspective to the subject matter.
Our service learning programs focus specifically on health promotion abroad. In Brazil, we travel to communities and work with them to embrace their community initiatives and understand healthcare in context in Brazil.
Graduate students do research on projects related to the goals of USAID. We had a plant biology doctoral student in central Brazil looking at cocoa plants and the genetics of disease resistance.
There's so much going on in emerging markets like Brazil that we have to put that into our curriculum at Rutgers Business School.
Joining us now to share special insight into the relationship between Rutgers and Brazil is Dr. Raul Machado, professor and provost for the International Cooperation at the University of São Paulo, or USP, a key partner in Brazil. Bom dia, doutor.
Bom dia. Good morning.
Rutgers shares a unique relationship with the University of São Paulo, or USP. Can you describe that history?
Yes. We have been in touch, collaborating for more than 50 years. Especially only a few professors here, a few professors over there, not institutionally. But in 1997, with one workshop, one very special workshop on agriculture biotechnology, changed this trajectory. We become more institutional. We, from this workshop, we started to work on a tripartite PhD program that is in place now. It is a very important tripartite PhD program with Ohio, combined with Ohio. And also, we another area that we benefit from this relationship is the exchange of undergraduate research students. Since in 1998, we are having students from Brazil, from University of São Paulo, spent 1 or 2 weeks here, and students from Rutgers spent 1 or 2 weeks over there in São Paulo. This is becoming so fantastic because open the minds, open the opportunities for them.
So, Dr. Machado, building off of that, how important is it for students and faculty to have that global exchange and internationalization to be able to cross borders?
It is, when you being exposed to a different academic environment, you think differently. And this is one opportunity, very unique opportunity for the student to see different environment and create solutions and create perspectives that include other countries, other cultures. This is very unique.
And how would you say that this collaboration benefits both universities?
It's a complementary relationship. Is in some areas we are very much important for Rutgers, and other areas Rutgers is important, is more important for the University of São Paulo. And like oceanography, is the gliders technology that is in place here at Marine and Coastal Science Department is being very useful to establish the gliders technology at the University of São Paulo, that we are now responsible for South Atlantic information, and Rutgers is responsible for North Atlantic information. Areas that we are complementing in biofuels, for instance. Biofuel, our experience, our accumulated experience on biofuels is also very important for Rutgers. It's a complementary initiatives.
And where do you see this mutually beneficial relationship going in the future?
More, we expect more double degrees, like oceanographic is working on double degrees, and atmospheric science is working on double degrees with our people over there. And also, we are trying to establish an International Institute of Americas over there, a TIA, T-I-A, that will be a virtual combination, virtual alliance of laboratories, of projects, for 3 universities, Ohio, Rutgers, University of São Paulo.
Muito obrigado, doutor. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Bruno, where did you learn how to speak Portuguese?
Well, I learned a lot of it from my parents, and I've also been fortunate enough to go to Portugal almost every summer, so I get a lot of exposure from it over there, too. Do you speak any other languages?
I do. I learned Spanish from my family as well, and I even studied the language during my time here at Rutgers. Now, let's go to Argentina and take a look at what Rutgers Graduate School of Education students are doing there.
Rosario is a really unique city for study abroad. It's a large enough city that it offers everything that you would want to do in the cultural aspects and the arts, but it's small enough where you feel like you can really get to learn the city. The overarching goal of this program is to give the Rutgers students the opportunity to be exposed to the challenges facing the educational systems in a Latino American society and culture. There's only so much culture that can be taught within the confines of a traditional classroom. They have daily experience, not just in the formal setting of the school, but also in an informal setting, living with house families. And then they have the daily life setting where they're out and about in the streets and they have to negotiate ordering food and buying clothes.
One of the best parts, the fact that there was the structured language classes, and then also just having the freedom in the afternoon and the evening to kind of do what we wanted to. I sing, so I actually made a friend who played the guitar and who sang, and we actually recorded a song. Like, I went to Argentina and recorded a song. Like, I still can't believe that. The first day I got there, I could barely communicate with my host mom because she only spoke Spanish. So it was like, wow, I really have to challenge myself to use the skills that I know. By that last dinner that we had the day before I left, the conversation we had was so complex, and like it's kind of unbelievable to think that 3 weeks before we barely were able to communicate.
This program has a service learning component in a local school in the outskirts of Rosario in a neighborhood that's been traditionally challenged with poverty and gang violence and domestic violence. So this school is kind of like a beacon of light for the students that are in this community, because it's a school that takes a holistic approach to education and offers the students an opportunity to be supported not just in their academics but also in their own personal development. So this program allows our students to go into the school environment, be supportive in any way that they need.
The students, they just want to know. They're hungry for knowledge and they feel appreciated that we were there.
We're there to be as helpful as we possibly can and also to offer a cultural exchange to these students. A lot of these students who don't have the opportunity to travel abroad, the local students, this is a way kind of to bring that international life to them just by our presence in the school.
I think it's a wonderful program and, you know, everybody will learn a lot.
I definitely think this program gave me that ultimate motivation to continue to learn Spanish and continue to learn languages and travel and meet people.
So far, we've covered Rutgers students and faculty members studying and doing research in other countries. Now, let's take a look at international students and faculty who travel here to Rutgers. Joining me now are Mohini Mukherjee, the Associate Director of Student Services at the Center for Global Services, an arm of the Gaia Centers, and undergraduate international student Gian Baquerizo from Ecuador. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. And Mohini, how does the Center for Global Services assist in international students, faculty, and scholars?
Like you said, we are the Center for Global Services. We are here to offer services to all incoming international students, faculty, and scholars. And we are part of the umbrella global organization at Rutgers, which is the Gaia Centers, the Centers for Global Advancement and International Affairs. Our role here is primarily to offer immigration advice as well as demystify the federal immigration regulations that govern the status of these international students, faculty, and scholars that come to Rutgers. Along with maintaining institutional compliance and assisting the international students, faculty, and scholars in maintaining their legal status, we also offer a lot of programming to the international students. So part of our programming begins with the international student orientation and is followed up with programs like the International Friendship Program, which continue throughout their stay here.
So, Gian, you're from Ecuador, and how did the Global Services Department help you with your transition?
They helped me starting with my arrival. The international student orientation was great to know what I had to do and what papers I had to have in order to stay with my legal status. And they've been helping me throughout the whole process perfectly.
So what made you choose Rutgers?
School spirit, what Rutgers is, what Rutgers represents, diversity, opportunity, academic achievement, that's what made me choose Rutgers.
And Mohini, have you seen an increase of students from Latin America?
I would say there is a trend for increase in international students in general, and certainly from Latin America as well, because we have a lot of existing MOUs with many Latin American countries, a lot of work in creating more exchange agreements. We have over 130 students from Latin America and are only looking to grow that number.
Do you think anything sparked students from Latin America coming in general? Any changes?
I think there are a number of factors. You know, there's social, economic, just academic, research, interest-based factors, and all of that contribute to the growth in numbers from a certain region.
And Gian, what would you say to international students looking to go into Rutgers?
Just go forward with it. Rutgers is a great place to be at, and yeah, just go ahead and do it.
Thank you both so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
Up next, we'll take a closer look at cross-cultural understanding when it comes to an important subject, health. Reporter and alum Aya Hashia has the story.
Thanks, Gabriella. Global Health is a cross-disciplinary orientation promoting access to and understanding of healthcare worldwide. And at Rutgers, we have a number of global health projects based in Mexico that have meaningful impacts here and abroad.
Rutgers has strong ties with Mexico. The city of New Brunswick in particular has a vibrant migrant Oaxacan community that give the Rutgers community an in-depth look into critical global and public health concerns in the United States and Mexico.
There's a big concern about issues of obesity and diabetes both in Mexico and here. The first project we did was on dietary change among Oaxacan migrants. So we wanted to learn more about what happens to people's diets when they migrate.
One of our faculty members, Dr. Karen Alonso, has been doing some work
with a group of women from Oaxaca who are here in New Brunswick. She's been able to do research on biomarkers with them here and has looked at a similar group of women in the same town in Oaxaca, Mexico. We found a lot of issues around diabetes and metabolic syndrome that was undiagnosed here as well as in Oaxaca.
Rutgers has developed partnerships in Mexico that result in knowledge exchanges with institutions.
SUNEA wants to have advanced practice nursing. The role of nurses is very strong, and there's a lot of them, and there's not enough physicians. So it doesn't make sense to deny access to care for some patients if we can't give the nurses the skills to be able to dispense medications. And that's something that this university has talked about us helping out with them.
The Center for Global Public Health is conducting a National Institutes of Health-funded study in Mexico City. And this research has the potential to save lives.
A particular municipality in Mexico traditionally had been known to have a lot of tuberculosis patients and a lot of air pollution. We wash lungs from volunteers. We also take blood samples. And then we isolate from the washed lung fluid cells that we call macrophages. These are cells that gobble up particles. We know what these cells should do when they are confronted with the bacteria. And when they have these particles in them, they cannot do this job as well. And that could be an indication that air pollution could make our lung defenses weaker and allow bacterial infections such as tuberculosis to develop.
Students can also engage in a service learning program to Oaxaca.
The Culture Community Health Program in Oaxaca is a 5-week program that combines the study of medical anthropology and volunteer placements in different community health settings. On weekends, we do cultural excursions. So we go to a weaving cooperative. We learn about traditional healing. They are living and working in Spanish the entire time.
Through study abroad experiences, students learn cultural aspects of health and healing in other parts of the world.
In Oaxaca, alternative medicine is a lot more popular. It's very interesting that doctors had to kind of understand both so that they could help their patients, but at the same time, kind of relate to them.
And for many students, these experiences help clear any doubts about their future.
I ask them to write about what they've learned, and I actually tell them they can't start the essay for a month because I feel like it takes that long for them to really absorb. For many of them, it solidifies their commitment to a career in health.
Aya, the air pollution exposure story in Mexico City appears to be a large multidisciplinary study.
It is. Dr. Stefan Schwander at the Rutgers School of Public Health has been working with several collaborators. The research is taking place at the National Institute for Respiratory Diseases in Mexico City. That's a lab Dr. Schwander knows well because he's been working with them for about 20 years.
Thanks, Aya. From Mexico, we turn our attention to the issue of healthcare accessibility throughout Latin America.
We're joined by Dr. Ziad Sifri, an associate professor of surgery and director of the Global Surgery Fellowship at Rutgers New Jersey Medical School. Dr. Sifri is also president of the International Surgical Health Initiative, or ISHI.
Thank you for joining us, Dr. Sifri.
Thank you for having me, guys.
Are there people in the world who don't have access to adequate surgical care?
Yes, absolutely. I think most people don't know there's about 5 billion people around the world who have no access to surgical care. It's either not available, or it's not safe, or it's just too expensive.
And could you explain, or you created the International Surgical Health Initiative, or ISHI, to help patients in third world countries. Could you explain what ISHI is?
So ISHI is a volunteer-driven organization that provides surgical care to places where we're invited around the world, typically in low, middle-income countries, poor areas where they may have an OR, they may have this setup, but they don't have access to a surgeon. So we provide services for free, surgical care services, in those countries, and we establish a long-term relationship with these hospitals. We provide care for the patients. We also provide training during the mission to some of their staff and employees so that some of the knowledge can stay behind once the mission is complete. Once we've established a long-term relationship with the hospital, we start focusing on capacity building. So once we understand the issues at play, we really focus on trying to see how we can help the hospital provide more surgical care in any way we can.
And who donates to these services? And how do you acquire volunteers?
So our volunteers are very passionate. They actually will fundraise to sponsor their own travel, which is the most expensive part of the trip, the airline ticket. And we will do small fundraising. Most of the time, it's family members, friends, or colleagues that are inspired by the work that's getting done and will donate to the organization to sponsor the mission.
And could you give us an update on your efforts in Peru, Ecuador, and Guatemala?
Absolutely. So we have a very strong relationship with Peru. We go on a yearly basis to a town called Trujillo. We provide surgical services. We've also met medical students from Trujillo, and we've taken our medical students to have some knowledge exchange, to have some better understanding of the challenges of providing healthcare or surgical care in a place like Trujillo. We're also invited to provide more education in different parts of town, and we have students developing a pilot project for outreach programs within Trujillo.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
That's it for our episode on Latin America and the Caribbean.
Please join us next time for another look at Rutgers around the world, where we'll explore relationships in Asia. I'm Bruno Ferreira.
And I'm Gabriela Milian. Thanks for watching.